वक्रतुण्डमहाकाय सूर्यकोटिसमप्रभ निर्विघ्नं कुरु मे देव सर्वकार्येषु सर्वदा सरस्वतिनमस्तुभ्यं वरदे कामरूपिणि विद्यारम्भं करिष्यामि सिद्धिर्भवतु मे सदा। गुरवे सर्वलोकानां विषजे भवरोगिणां निधये सर्वविद्यानां दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः। ईश्वरो गुरुरात्मेति मूर्तिभेदविभागिने व्योमवद्व्याप्तदेहाय दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः। सदाशिवसमारम्भां शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम्। श्रुतिस्मृतिपुराणानाम् आलयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पादं शङ्करं लोकशङ्करम्। साक्षात्कृतं दयानन्दं परमार्थस्वरूपिणं तत्त्वज्ञानप्रशास्तारं प्रणतोऽस्मि परं पदम्। ॐ सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यङ्करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। Today's our 8th class 2, the introduction to Vedanta. We are discussing on Purushartha. The word Purushartha, we know, by the word Purushartha, what we mean is human goals, the goals which every human being wants to achieve, Purushartha. And this Purushartha, our Shastram presents or classifies into Dharma, Artha, Kama. And one more Purushartha is there, Moksha. First, the three Purusharta about which we discussed, Artha Purusharta, Kama Purusharta, and Dharma Purusharta. First of all, why do we seek this Purusharta? The reason is, I feel I am insignificant. I am insecure. The feeling that I am insecure, that is the cause. That is the cause which propels me to seek for security. Because I am insecure. I want to be secure. I want to be secure in terms of money, in terms of relationship, in terms of in physical, social, psychological, any economical, any security. Therefore, artha is all those things that which are required for security, that which we seek for our security and survival. That is artha. But the reason behind seeking artha is the feeling that I am insecure. Therefore, I seek artha. Similarly, why do I seek kama? What is kama? All those things which I acquire for pleasure, for satisfaction, that is kama. That is kama. Why do I seek kama? Because I am not satisfied. Because I am not satisfied with myself. I am not at home. So therefore, I want satisfaction. I want fulfillment. I want happiness. And I am not secure. I am small. I am insignificant. These are the basic the notions which a human being has. Therefore, he goes after artha and kama. And how many arthas, how many kamas are possible? Anything you achieve, artha or kama, I am a wanting person. That doesn't undergo any change. You analyze yourself when you are after any artha and kama, after gaining your artha kama. Does the notion, that the feeling I am wanting, does it undergo any change? I want this, it is accomplished. And after that, I want something else. That also is accomplished. And after that, I want something else. That also accomplished. And after that, I want to get rid of something. So that wants keeps on coming. The want keeps on coming. Therefore, it has no end. Artha has no end and kama has no end. I always seek something which I feel it will give me security, it will give me satisfaction. Therefore, I remain a wanting person. I always want something different, something more lasting. And the satisfaction is not there. Neither artha as as the purushartha, as the goal, it gives me the total security. Nor the kama as the purushartha, it gets me total satisfaction. So therefore, I'm neither satisfied being what I am, nor I feel secure in spite of accomplishing all the artha pursuits. Therefore, I am insecure and I am not satisfied. So these two things, it always, always there. In spite of achieving any amount of artha kama, these two things, I am insecure and I am not satisfied, that makes me feel that I am small, I am insignificant. That always continues. So therefore, it is clear this artha kama that you gain in keeping with dharma, or by dharma you get punyam so that you will get more artha kama. So these three, dharma, artha, kama, these three purusharthas have limitations. They have limitations. These three are the common purusharthas. Every human being, invariably you will find either you will be after artha or kama. And if he is a person, a dharmika person, he will try to accomplish artha kama in keeping with dharma. Otherwise, he will use any means to accomplish that. you will violate the dharma, you will violate the order. If you take any human being, they are busy pursuing artha and kama. For what? For security and for satisfaction. But do they get? Whole life they spend seeking artha and kama. So they, therefore, they are after many things. So they don't get the security what they seek. Family cannot give security. Relationship cannot give security, cannot give happiness. Therefore, this artha kama has they have limitations. What are the limitations? What are the limitations if you ask? These three purusharthas, by which the end what you accomplish, they are not going to be everlasting. They are not going to be permanent. They have a certain expiry date. Like if you buy a medicine, a product, any product, date of manufacture and date of expiry is similarly, these three purusharthas also have expiry date. They will go away in time. Therefore, because these three purusharthas you achieve by your action, by your karma. You do karma and by that you gain the end in the form of the purusharthas, three purusharthas, dharma, artha, kama. Because karma is limited, any karma is limited. You cannot do unlimited, infinite karma. Not possible. Is it possible? Any karma is done with your body, mind, sense complex. Body is limited. Mind also limited. Sense is limited. So with the limited means you accomplish the limited sadhyam. The ends are also limited only. You cannot gain unlimited ends by the limited means. It is not possible logically also. Therefore, these three purusharthas, the three ends what we gain, they are not permanent. They are not permanent. They are anityam. In Sanskritam we say they are anityam. By gaining a artha, you think I am secure. But will it give security forever? That may be secure, that may give you this feeling of security, the sense of security for the time being. Maybe for a certain period of time. But after that, that will go away. It will not give you permanent security. There's nothing in the world which can give you permanent security. No relationship can give you permanent security. Every human being is limited. How can you expect permanent security from the relationship? Not possible. Father is limited. Mother is also limited. Kid, children, spouse, everybody is limited. So you cannot expect permanent security from the relationship. Similarly, you cannot expect permanent security from the wealth. It has limitation. So therefore, therefore, this anityam, that is a nature. That is a nature of this the purushartha, dharma artha kama purushartha. It is a nature. So we cannot blame it. That is how they are anityam. That is one defect, one limitation. And the other one is anything you gain in the form of artha or kama, that will be always mixed with dukkham, pain. Even in accomplishing artha and kama, dukkham is there. Without dukkham, without effort, every effort in gaining artha kama involves pain, involves pain is there. No pain, no gain. Therefore, in gaining Arthakama, pain is there because you have to put work effort, you have to work for it. And after gaining that, you have to work to retain. Therefore, again, the effort and therefore the pain is involved. And also, it is not going to give you security and happiness forever. Therefore, to retain it, you have to do a lot of compromises. You have to put a lot of effort. That involves the dukkham, pain is there. Therefore, we say, in acquiring Arthakama, in gaining Arthakama, there is pain. Rakshane, arjane dukkham. First, in gaining, there is dukkham. And after you gain, you have to protect it so that it will not go away. Therefore, rakshane dukkham. Arjane dukkham. Rakshane dukkham. In gaining, there is pain. In retaining that also, there is pain. Dukkham is involved. Therefore, and also, while experiencing the Arthakama, it is not that it will going to give you the security and pleasure continuously. It is not possible. There is nothing in the world which gives you continuous security or continuous pleasure. Say, for example, you like rasagulla. You like rasagulla, it is sweet, delicious. How much you will take? If you take two rasagulla, or even at the maximum 10, or even if you consume one full box, after that, if I give one more box, will you be able to consume? No, you will say, enough. I can't take any more. You say, enough. The same rasagulla, which is sweet and delicious, you like it, you say enough of it. I don't want it anymore. So it has got limit. You cannot consume any amount of it. It's not possible. It has got limitation. And after some rasagulla, you start hating it. Enough, not required. Therefore, dukkham is there. There is nothing without dukkham. This is another limitation, another defect. Dukkha mishra tattvam. Anything you gain in the form of artha kama, it is always mixed with dukkham. You want ananda, therefore you are after artha kama. You want security, therefore you go after artha, but they are mixed with dukkham. This is the second defect. Dukkha mishra tattvam. And once you gain Arthakama, when they go away, there is dukkham, tremendous dukkham, unbearable dukkham. In gaining, there is dukkham. In maintaining, there is dukkham. And when it goes away, because they have to go away, they cannot remain forever. They are limited. Nashane dukkham. When it is gone, then also dukkham. So, beginning, middle, and end. In three places they are dukkham. Then how can it be a source of happiness? How can it be a source of satisfaction or security? It cannot be, but that is what we are after. Therefore, this is another defect. The first one is, it is anityam. The second one is dukkha mishra tattva. The third one is, the third defect is, the Arthakama, what you gain, it will never give you total satisfaction. You don't stop with what you achieve in terms of Arthakama. You don't stop with that. You always want more. Idil mange more. You don't stop there. You always want more and more. First you gain, you gain a certain artha or kama, that you gain a momentary satisfaction that is not going to be a long satisfaction. It's only a momentary satisfaction. Therefore, again, you are after it. That also gives you a momentary satisfaction. So therefore, that satisfaction seeking will always be there. It will never go. The purpose of seeking Arthakama is give you satisfaction. It gives satisfaction for the time being. And when the satisfaction is slowly diminishing, then you want more. It means it is not fully satisfying. Therefore, this is another defect. This is inherently the Arthakama as the defect. This is how the Jagat is. We cannot blame it. This is how the order is. But therefore, the third defect is Atripti Karaha. Tripti means satisfaction. Tripti is satisfaction. The satisfaction is a word. It's only for the time being. Satisfaction. I am satisfied. You say now, but you will not say the same thing tomorrow. Because your goals are changed now. And even after you accomplish the goal, you will try to improve upon it. Because there is a possibility. Therefore, it can never give you a total long lasting. There is no long lasting. Because there is, it's all limited. Therefore, you can say it is never satisfying. That is the nature of these Arthakama goals. Atripti Karaha. These are the three defects. We can add one more defect also. That another defect because of this is once I am after this Arthakama, I want to enjoy the continuous Arthakama. Because it is, the nature is, it is anitya. Therefore it goes away. But I have experienced these relative security, a relative satisfaction. So therefore I work for it continuously. I don't give up. I work for it continuously. So therefore there is an addiction. There is an addiction. The addiction in gaining and retaining further. It creates a bondage without which you cannot live. Without which you cannot live. Therefore, you become totally dependent on that Arthakama. The Arthakama becomes the factor for you to depend. You become more dependent on Arthakama. You cannot live without that. I cannot live without my mobile. Now, mobile is the source of bandha. Mobile has got utility. It doesn't bandha. Because it is bandha, it doesn't mean I should throw away my mobile. It has its utility. But you see, it serves a purpose only that much. If mobile is not there, we should learn to live without mobile also. See, therefore, that Arthakama creates addiction, a bondage, a bandha, a dependency. Relationship, when the relationship becomes a bandha, it will become a problem. You become more dependent on the other person emotionally, emotional dependence. And nobody can really give you emotional security. You depend on the other person, seeking that the other person is the source of your security, your happiness, but nobody is really speaking. You think, therefore, you depend. And you cannot live without that person, whoever it may be. You depend on money. You depend on your assets. You depend on the social status. You depend on your recognition, your influence. And you will be, after that, always, you want more and more. You want to be more influential person. So therefore, it creates a dependency. It creates a dependency that is called bandhakatvam. That is the nature of the pursuits of Arthakama. Any arthakama you take, it will create this dependency. Slowly, slowly you will develop a liking for it, and they will put you in a circumstance where you cannot live without that addiction, like a drug. The drug, it is in the beginning, it is very pleasant. It gives joy. You enjoy that, but later you cannot live without that. It creates the addiction, the bondage. It's already coffee also. You are addicted to coffee. Coffee as such, it doesn't have any problem. Your addiction to that, without which you cannot live, when you say, then it is a bandha, a bondage. So anything which binds you, without which you cannot live, that doesn't make you free. That doesn't make you a comfortable person. That is the nature of this artha kama. This is another defect, bandhakatva. Therefore, these three purusharthas, dharma, artha, and kama, what a human being tries to accomplish through all his life, they have these limitations. They are not defect-free purusharthas. They are sadosha purusharthas. In Sanskritam we say dosha. Dosha is defect. These are the inherent defects of the purusharthas. Sadosha purusharta. So, anityattvam, impermanency, and dukkha mishritvam, it is mixed with dukkha, pain, and atripti karatvam, it doesn't give you satisfaction, and the last one is bandhakatvam, it binds you. These three purusharthas have these inherent limitations, and this, a person who has viveka, viveka meaning the ability, the capacity to discriminate, to discern and understand the limitations of this three purusharta, that ability is called viveka. One has to examine, analyze these three purusharta, understand, discern that is called viveka, that capability is called viveka, and the person is called viveki. Viveki purushaha, dhiraha, in the language of Bhagavad Gita, the word for that is dhiraha, dhiraha purushaha. You will find in many places, Bhagavan Krishna uses the word dhiraha, viveki. And Nachiketa in Kathopanishad is a viveki, dhiraha purushaha. Why Nachiketa? Because these three purusharthas about which Lord Yamadharmaraja is a teacher. In Kathopanishad, Yamadharmaraja is a teacher. Nachiketa is the student. He's an extraordinary student. He's a Viveki. And when Yamadharmaraja offered him a lot of artha and kama, which a human being cannot imagine, he just dismissed the offer, saying that these are only ephemeral, temporary. I don't need that. Because he asked for something else, which Yamadharmaraja did not give immediately. He wanted to test Nachiketa to see, he wants to evaluate the disciple. He doesn't want to give away right away what he asked. He did not ask anything material. He asked for knowledge. Anyway, we will talk about that later. So, Nachiketa is such a viveki person, and Yamadharmaraja was so pleased with his viveka, Vairagya. And finally, he gave what he wanted. And in that Kathopanishad, Yamadharmaraja, when he teaches Nachiketa, he says, these three Purusharta, Dharma, Artha, Kama, Purusharta, these three are Sadosha Purusharthas, and they have a common name called Prayas. They have a common name called Prayas. What is Prayas? Seeking pleasant things. Seeking pleasant is called Prayas. Seeking pleasant, that which pleases you, that which gives you security, that which gives you happiness, a relative fulfillment. That is called Prayas. In other words, this three Purusharta, Dharma, Artha, Kama Purusharta, together are called Prayas. The person who is after Prayas is called Prayurthi. The person who is after Prayas is called Prayurthi, the seeker of Prayas. The seeker of Dharmartha Kama is called Prayurthi. The seeker of Artha is called Artharthi. The seeker of Kama is called Kamarthi. The seeker of Dharma is called Dharmarthi. The seeker of Dharma, Artha, Kama together, it is called Prayas. Therefore, three are called Prayas. Therefore, Prayurthi. So, Yamadharmaraja, he talks about Prayas. And then he talks about Shreyas. That we will see. So, therefore, these three Purusharthas have limitation. The limitations have to be understood. That can be understood only when you analyze the three Purusharthas. And really speaking, do we are in search or in gaining, really gain in seeking these three Purusharthas? What I really want is total security. What I really want is the total, the satisfaction, a fulfillment, a contentment, the completeness. That is what I really want. If I want total security, which I tried to gain through Artha, Artha cannot give because it is limited. But I want security, a total security, not relative security, total security. I superimpose total security, that is the end, on the limiter Artha, and after I gain Artha, I am disappointed because I did not get the total security. It is my mistake because I seek total security through the limited Artha Purushartha. Because I don't know that it is, the end is limited. But the end is limited. How do you know? After you gain the Artha, you know. After you accomplish the end, Artha is the end, you accomplish the end and you come to know it doesn't give me the total security. But what I really want is total security. If I want total security, then it cannot be something other than myself. Because there is nothing in the world, not any one thing which we can call total security. Are you seeking security or are you seeking freedom from security? This has to be analyzed. One has to ask this question and think, are you seeking security or are you seeking freedom from security? In fact, what you are seeking is freedom from insecurity. You don't want to be insecure. Therefore, you seek freedom from being insecure. What you are seeking is freedom from dissatisfaction. You don't want to be dissatisfied. You don't want to have that sense of dissatisfaction. You want to be free from that. Therefore, freedom from insecurity, freedom from dissatisfaction, freedom from discontentment freedom from incompleteness, inadequacy. This is what we seek. Freedom from being an insignificant person, freedom from being a smallness. This is what we seek. What we seek is freedom. What we seek is freedom. Freedom means what? Freedom means freedom from something I don't want. And the word for freedom is moksha. The word for freedom is moksha. So moksha means freedom from something I don't want. The word, the moksha, the word, it is derived from the dhatu much. In Sanskritam, we will be seeing. Every word you will find as its root, verbal root will be there. So the moksha, the word, is derived from the dhatu much. Much meaning freedom. Freedom from something you don't want. Freedom from something you don't want. And this freedom, this though we define freedom, it is in a negative sense, because freedom from freedom from what I don't want. This freedom is one of the purushartha. It is not one of the purushartha. It is in the beginning we think in the, this freedom in the beginning we think it is one of the purushartha. Therefore we say dharmartha kama moksha purushartha. We say, but we have analyzed the three purushartha and we have come to the conclusion what I seek is really freedom. Through artha kama, what I seek is really freedom, and therefore we have to discuss moksha purushartha as though a separate purushartha, but it is not. Really speaking, all these three purushartha finally narrows down to freedom only, and that is the end. And moksha is the purushartha, it is the end common to everybody. Everybody wanting to be free. It is not something peculiar to only me, to me. Everybody wants to be free. Everybody wants to be free from certain things that are common to all. That I am attached to particular forms of security, artha. That reveals the fact that I am insecure. I also I seek pleasures, kama. That reveals that I am restless. I am not satisfied with myself. Therefore, I have to do something to please myself, which means I am displeased with myself now. Therefore, if you are always seeking security and pleasure throughout your life, when will you make your life? When you will be able to say that I have made it now? You can say that only when you see yourself as a secure person, when you see yourself as a satisfied person, then only you are free. Then only you have moksha. Therefore, that moksha is centered on not any external things. It is centered on myself. It is centered on myself. I must see myself as secure. I must see myself as a pleased, as a satisfied person. I must be pleased with myself as I am. Then only I have moksha. Moksha doesn't mean salvation. Please note, moksha, we don't translate the word salvation. There's nothing to salvage. We don't have any word for salvation in Sanskritam. Salvation, the word, it connotes a certain condemnation of yourself. It means you need someone to salvage you, to save you. That is not the moksha. Moksha means that I want to be free, freeing of myself from certain conditions, certain self-imposed conditions. That is called freedom. And the basic self-imposed notions are, I am insecure, I am not satisfied with myself. And that, freedom from that is moksha. If I am secure and pleased with myself, then I require no security, or I don't require any situation to change, whatever it may be, to be secure and to be at peace, because I am secure, I'm pleased with myself. And therefore, you don't need to spend your whole life manipulating the world to please yourself, because you are a pleased person. Basically, you are a pleased person. Basically, you are a secure person. And knowing the fact that I am secure, I am pleased, you become free. Therefore, the real freedom is freedom from being a seeking person. The freedom is not in the happiness, or the security is not in gaining things. The security and happiness is being free from seeking. That is a freedom. Freedom is freedom from being a seeking person. Freedom from being a seeker. I don't want to be a seeker. I don't want to be a seeking person anymore. Therefore, when we look into our various pursuits, artha, dharma and kama, what we really seek is none of these three. None of these three purusharthas. Though we have discussed in detail and we have seen the limitations and all, those discussions finally it has led us to the conclusion what we seek is only freedom. We seek only freedom from being a seeker. I am seeking freedom from being insecure, being an incomplete person. Therefore, moksha is the pursuit. Therefore, moksha is the pursuit. And that is what every human being after. And the word for moksha is shreyas. And the word for moksha is shreyas. The word which Yamadharma Raja uses in Kathopanishad for the word moksha is shreyas. And the person after moksha is called shreyorthi. And the person who is after moksha is called shreyorthi. Shreyas is seeking good. What is good for you? What is good? What is good? Freedom is good. Therefore, another word for moksha is shreyas. In fact, through prayers, what we seek is shreyas only. What we seek is shreyas. Though majority of the people are after shreyas, only a few people are after shreyas, and this shreyas people, they would have done a lot of analysis of the prayers and come to the conclusion that this world is constantly changing and nothing can please, nothing can give me security. Therefore, it must be myself. They would have come to the conclusion the world is not the cause of my happiness, not the cause of my problem. The problem is what I have. I am the problem, and the solution for that is I am the solution. The solution is not artha or kama. The solution is not wealth. The solution is not the relationship. The solution is not anything other than me. Therefore, in the vision of our Shastram, there is no reason for you to feel being insecure or you to be displeased with yourself, because you are fine being what you are. You are already secure. You are already a person, a complete person. You don't lack anything. That is a vision. That is a vision of our Shastram. It is not a belief. It is a fact. It is a fact which has to be discovered. The fact is that you lack nothing. You are totally free. That is the vision of Vedanta. The problem in the beginning, I lack. Now I am complete. The problem that I lack is because of ignorance, not knowing the nature, the real nature of myself. I take myself to be a mortal person, to be a limited person, without knowing the nature of myself. Therefore, I say I lack. I'm not free. I'm insecure. But Vedanta, Shastram, it says the problem is not what you lack, not that you lack, that the sense that you lack what you have, it is a problem. And for that problem, the solution is doesn't lie in external things, external objects. The solution is you. You are the problem and you are the solution. You are the problem and the solution for that is you only. You see, there are two types of problems in general. In one type, the solution from the problem lies outside. Lies outside the problem. And for the other type, the solution lies within the problem itself. The solution lies within the problem. For example, if you feel cold, that's a problem. And the solution for that lies outside. Either you cover yourself or you have to go near the fire or go out to the sun. The solution is outside. If you are hungry, the solution is outside. You have to appease your hunger by having food. And now here, this problem. Now let us take another one. A puzzle is there. The puzzle is there. The solution to the puzzle is within the puzzle itself. It is not outside the puzzle. You are solving a mathematical equation or mathematical puzzle. And the solution for the puzzle lies inside the puzzle, not outside. The solution is within the problem. In fact, there is no problem. In fact, there is no problem. The solution is there within the problem. In the case of mathematical equation or a puzzle, Sudoku, you solve. The solution to that lies within the problem. In fact, when we talk about problem, there is no problem at all. Problem and solution, we talk only when problem is there. The two types of problem, external problem and that is the problem for which the solution lies outside, or the problem for which the solution lies inside. These two types of problem is not there with regard to you. Because the problem itself is not there. There is no problem. That is what our Shastram says. The problem is a relative problem. Relative because you superimpose on yourself certain things which you are not. That is a problem. Therefore, the only problem is you. You are the problem. The real nature of you is not a problem. The real nature of what you are is not a problem. You are your superimposition. You think your notion of that I lack, that I want, that is a problem. Really speaking, you don't lack anything. You don't need anything to satisfy, to please yourself. You are complete. But we don't know that. We don't know the vision of the Shastram. We don't know the reality of ourselves. Therefore, we say the problem is you. When I say the problem is you, it is only in the relative sense. Really speaking, there is no problem. Anyway, therefore, relatively, the problem is you, and this problem, to solve this problem, where is the solution for this relative problem to get solved? Where is the solution? The solution is also you only, because the solution for this doesn't lie outside. The problem being you, that you cannot find a solution outside. And the problem being you, you cannot find the solution really inside also, because the problem itself is not there. So the discovery is that there is no problem. That is the discovery. The discovery is that there is no problem. In the beginning, we say the problem is you and the solution is you. But later we say there is no problem at all. You yourself will discover there is no problem. Only when you don't understand something, you say it's a problem for you. As long as you don't understand certain things, you have a problem. That not understanding is a problem. And for that, what is the solution? Understanding the solution. Was there really a problem? No problem. That is what Vedanta says. That is what our Shastram says. You have no problem. But you may ask, how can I recognize that I don't have a problem? For that, you have to study the Shastram. The Shastram has to be studied. The problem is, I am not acceptable to myself. The self-non-acceptance, that is a problem. But according to Shastram, self is acceptable. The self is always acceptable. It is always pleased. It is always complete. Therefore now, the Purusharta, the Moksha Purusharta, for the pursuit of Moksha Purusharta, what is the sadhya, what is the end? Knowing yourself. Knowing myself. Knowing myself is the end. That gives me freedom. Knowing myself gives me freedom. Therefore, the freedom must be myself. The freedom must be the nature of myself. That I seek freedom from external things, that is not correct. Seeking the nature of myself being freedom and seeking that freedom from external things is a mistake. That is a mistake we do. That is a mistake every human being commonly does. And for that mistake, for that problem, and the problem is because of the notions, not because of the certain notions, Vedanta gives a solution. And the problem is because of non-understanding. And Vedanta gives you the knowledge that gives you understanding, and you recognize that I am acceptable as I am. I'm always acceptable as I am. I don't need to modify. I don't need to condemn myself being what I am, because I'm a complete person. I'm free from the sense of want. I'm no more a wanting person. I'm a free person, and I'm acceptable. I don't need to improve upon myself. You cannot, in fact, improve upon yourself to become a better person. The word better is a relative term. You always, you know, you can be better, better, better. But the real nature of you cannot be better than what you are. And recognizing that, understanding that, that is freedom. That gives you freedom. That gives you the moksha. That makes you free from any psychological or dependence, emotional dependence. You become a free person. With Arthakama, you are free. Without Arthakama, then also you are free. You enjoy all the Arthakama, and it is no more a factor of bondage for you. It is a luxury. Even your body, mind, senses becomes a luxury for you. With them you enjoy. Without them also you are free. Because your nature is freedom. Your nature is that you are complete. That is why we chant Purnamadaha Purnamidam. Purnaha. You are complete. Purnaha means complete. Purnaha means Ishvara. We will see later how the word Purna is Ishvara. That which is complete must be Bhagavan. That which is complete, that which doesn't need any securities, can be only Bhagavan. What do we ask from Bhagavan? We pray to Bhagavan for security. We pray to Bhagavan for all the sorts of karma. And that is Bhagavan, because Bhagavan doesn't lack anything. He is complete. You ask from the complete person what you don't have. But Shastram says you are complete. You are complete. You are free. So what else you need? Then everything else in your life becomes a luxury. All the things what you have, it is a luxury. So you will enjoy with that. Even without that, you will remain a free person. Nothing can bind you. That is possible only when you understand. Understanding is involved. Now our problem is non-understanding or misunderstanding, because of which we suffer. Therefore, Shastram says, the reason for your suffering is your lack of understanding. You are the problem. And you want to be free from that, then understand. Where is the solution for that? Solution lies with you only. You have to understand. For understanding, you need to study the Shastram. Therefore, now the role of Shastram comes. Shastram has to play the role. And what is Shastram? What is the importance of Shastram? Why should we study Shastram? What do we gain from it? And what is the method? How we have to study the Shastram? How we have to approach this Shastram? Can it be studied independently? Or do I need a person? Or anybody, from anyone can I learn? Or do I need a person who has this knowledge, who comes under the tradition? All these things we'll be discussing one by one, slowly in different context from the next class. So we will stop here. Om Purnamadav Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om.
Dhanyavad Sharanji.
Dhanyavad Sharanji.
Dhanyavad Guruji.
Pranam Guruji.
Dhanyavad.
Thank you.